It's March 25, 2024. I'm at the World Health Organization, and we're here for a negotiation on a pandemic agreement. And then, could you introduce yourself? Tell people a little bit about yourself.
Thanks, Jamie. I'm Nithin. My full name is Nithin Ramakrishnan. I work with a Third World Network as a researcher. My organization looks into international negotiations at various forums from a development perspective.
Now, how do you think things have gone in INB9, the negotiation we're in right now?
So I've been looking at the negotiations at WHO, both in intergovernmental negotiating body for a new pandemic instrument, as well as the working group on amendments to international health regulations. So I've been there from last 2.5 years around. So the way we look at it, the current 9th meeting is in a very positive outlook, because currently the member states are being able to insert their text proposals into the text which has been circulated for negotiations, and they're able to defend it. I mean, they can actually retain the text back within the negotiating text until a convergence has arrived or they withdraw their proposals. Earlier it was mostly managed at the stage of, I would say, the draftsmen from Bureau or or the Secretary. So this time we are actually looking at real negotiations happening between states.
What advice are you giving to negotiators?
we are not in a position to give, you know, any form of advice to negotiators. But looking at from development perspective, I think there are three important. I may not be correct in prioritizing these demands, but when we look at the current status of international health emergencies, health emergency law, I think there are at least few demands which are very important. The first one being recognition of a development divide between developing countries and the developed countries. That would enable the kind of settings required for capacity building. You may have to require financial assistance or technology transfer for building capacities, both, you know, in surveillance, preparedness, and responding, including developing capacities for local production and research. And so that's very important. Second aspect when we come to the negotiations is the importance of equitable access to medicines as well as vaccines and other health products. So for that, there are various tools being proposed. The aspiration of a developing country people is that at least one of these proposals should come into reality rather than, you know, being watered down in the text-based negotiations. The last one with regard to the negotiations at INB9 and the demands or the interest of developing countries would be to look at the kind of investments and regulate where it is actually being spent is on a science-based and a priority-based areas. Because investing in beyond public health sectors may not be really the aspiration of developing country people at this point of time.
Has anything surprised you during INB9?
Surprised me in the sense it's actually not a surprise, but it's a little bit strange to speak about the kind of I would say the narrative about the need to stick to the deadline of May 2024. While it is important that we finish work in an efficient manner, what is being a little bit concerning is that whether this rushing towards the deadline will help us to get the content right. So for example, as I was trying to tell, all the past 8 INB meetings were not actually an interstate negotiations on the text. So we are hardly having a 9 to 10 days of negotiations on the current text. Is that enough for member states to agree upon a text and then come to a consensus? We are not very sure about it. Let the time tell whether it happens. And that's quite surprising, or, you know, quite strange for me to think about concluding on a text in 10 days of negotiations.
Before I turn the video off, is there anything else you'd like to add?
One of the things which I always like to emphasize is that when I look at or observe some of the negotiations and the informal narratives going around the corridors, one of the feelings which hurts us a lot is the kind of attitude from certain delegations which think that there is literally no capacities in the South, which is not true. We have capacities and it has to be enhanced. And that's even more, you know, the idea of taking things only the way North wants, only the way the health emergency preparedness, only the way North designs is not what we require. We need to take into account the aspirations or the conceptions or the solution models coming from the South as well, and take into account before just, you know, deciding upon what is the best practice for going forward as preparedness. So that would be my answer. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
I should be thankful. I should be very much thankful to you. Thank you. Thank you for this opportunity.